June 22nd, 2015 CPDC meeting. So just to give Dave a quick update, TRED has withdrawn their application. They're going to resubmit it, and they'll be before us again on the 13th.
Okay.
I guess they want to do some changes to the sign. So we'll keep moving. All right, so next up on the agenda, minor modification request to the PUDI special permit, Walker's Brook Crossing. And can I assume that we've got folks here from it? All right, that's what I figured. Excellent. All right, Jesse, you want to baseline us on this?
Sure. So we have with us the project team for Walker's Brook Crossing. They have a number of changes proposed for the site, mostly related to the former Met Grill space. They're proposing some breaking up of the space to accommodate some additional tenants. They also are doing some work to the mezzanine space that's located in the Golfsmith tenant space at the rear. And then they're also proposing some minor site improvements related to the dumpsters and adding a few patios, one for Oye's and one for the new, one of the proposed tenants. At the Mac Grill space, as well as the restaurant that's proposed at the Mac Grill space. They're also proposing a sidewalk that will lead you from the sort of the primary parking area back to the rear mezzanine space, which is going to be redone for additional commercial space. So I will let them walk you through the details, and we can go through any outstanding comments and go from there.
Great.
Yeah, go ahead, Jack.
Thanks.
My name is Brad Latham. I'm here with Mark Dickinson, Kelly Burke, and Ralph Coppola, who will be presenting tonight what the request is before you. For those that don't know Mark, Mark is the one who had the courage to take the Reading Dump and turn it into the Walker's Brook Crossing. I was remarked about that, having the courage to do that, which is quite a risky operation. As you know, with a large shopping center of this quality, from time to time, one has to change the tenants and the composition and the use of the area. And that's what's taking place here. We think there are upgrades. We think that outside restaurant facilities are a positive thing. I think it's worth buckling on. We've seen this with other facilities in town looking for that. So we have that change of space. We have the outside. And we also would like to make a presentation tonight with reference to signage. And give you some details that are in your package, but describe them to you, and look for relief in that regard. So at this point, I'm going to ask for Mark to make some opening remarks, and turn it over to Kelly, and then after that, Ralph will carry on. Thank you.
Thanks, Ralph. Hi, everybody. It's been a few years since I've been before this board. I spent many nights here in the selectman's office and various other town committees back about 10 years ago, but we were able to complete Walker's Brook Crossing in 2004-2005, first the Home Depot, Jordan's Furniture building, and the Chili's, and then phase two, which really opened up in 2005, included the Staples, the Golf Town, now Golfsmith, Starbucks, Bank of America, now Oye's, Paper Store, Verizon Store, a lot of good tenants. And over the last 10 years, I think the community has enjoyed having that shopping amenity here, and we certainly enjoy owning it and running it. It's been a very stable property until about a year and a half ago, when finally Not Going Grill, the Ghost, they were having a problem system-wide, not with the Reading store in particular, although I understand they did have some health violations there that were probably self-imposed. But they finally closed the store down
about 15 months ago.
Maybe 15 months ago they closed it down. And we've been working ever since trying to do something with the property, because it doesn't do the shopping center any good, doesn't do Macaroni Grill any good to have an empty store there. So with the Wilder Company, and specifically Andy LeGregor, was a partner in charge of leasing for the Wilder Company, we put together a re-tenanting plan that also involves a redesign of the building to something that's actually more compatible with the rest of the center than it was with the original Macaroni Grill that had their own kind of indigenous design. It was kind of plopped onto the end of the building. And I'll let Ralph Coppola here, who was the architect, explain exactly what we mean. But it's funny, we come back to Reading. We had dinner beforehand at the Venetian Moon Bread, kind of like renewing old acquaintances. So I'm glad to be back here tonight. I hope we can answer your questions, and I hope we can get expeditiously through this process. So thank you.
Good evening. My name is Kelly Burke, and I'm with the Wilder Companies. I'm going to start by talking about the mackerel demising first. And I start by outlining the total square footage of the former mackerel is 6,577 square feet. We'll be demising that into three tenant spaces, two high-quality national tenants. So we have the Anthony's Coal-Fired Pizza here taking 3,245 square feet. The middle space would be Chipotle at 2,268 square feet. And then on the end, Supercuts at 1,064 square feet. The Anthony's Coal-Fired Pizza will also include a patio on the side, which will include four-seat tables, as well as six bar seats that will be open. There'll be an opening in the side, and we'll show that in the elevation shortly. Internally, there will be a total of 80 seats, 16 on the patio plus the six bar seats. The Chipotle restaurant will have a total of 50 seats internally and a front small patio that will include 10 seats. And Supercuts will not have a patio, obviously, based on the use. Dumpsters would be reconfigured at the back here for the three tenant spaces. And as Jesse mentioned, there'll be a sidewalk that'll be constructed to link the front parking lot to the rear to assist with employees of the restaurants and tenant spaces, in addition to the employees that will be working in the mezzanine space that'll be converted, and I'll talk about that shortly. One comment that came up during the process of the application circulation was the town engineer, as well as the police chief, had concerns about the existing ramp and handicap spaces. As you can see them here, there are two handicap spaces and there are two curb ramps that ramp up to the sidewalk. Their concern was not that it didn't meet code, but that there wouldn't be appropriate clearance with the one side of the Chipotle patio. So we have subsequently made a revision that we'd like to present. I don't know, Paul, if you have, we don't have it on the screen.
No, we just talked about where we're going to adjust it one over.
Yeah, so essentially what will happen is, this is the existing condition. As you can see, it conflicts with the patio on this side. It doesn't conflict, you can still pass by it, but there'll be a shift in the handicap accessible spaces, and the ramp will also shift. So there will be adequate clearance to the railing system for Chipotle. The patios will be enclosed by railings. Those railings will be decorative black metal systems. They will look different. Anthony's patio will be a different style railing than Chipotle. That gives the tenants their own individual branding. And then there'll also be a small landlord's office at the back as well. If you could switch to the elevation, I'll just talk briefly. So Ralph from Main Street Architects is our architect. He will talk a little bit more about the architecture, but as you can see, it's much more compatible with these existing shopping center design than the mackerel design was. That was its own animal, if you will. We'll be replicating the cultured stone, natural stone pilasters, creating new openings to create new storefront systems for each tenant. There'll be new fenestrations proposed for the Anthony's Coal-Fired Pizza on the side elevation. And then this is the patio, so you can see the railing system here and the railing system for the Chipotle. In addition to these items, we're also including in the package the signage for each tenant, specifically Chipotle and Anthony's Coal-Fired Pizza. We don't have any signage in the package for Supercuts at this point. Chipotle sign will be 29 square feet, complies with zoning. Anthony's Coal Fired Pizza. We're proposing a sign on the front elevation. There is a sign here proposed on the side. That is not part of the application. That will be handled separately by the tenant. And this sign is 73.5 square feet, which is just slightly smaller than the current, the former Matt Grill sign that was there. I'd like to talk a little bit about the mezzanine at this point. These are the internal floor plans. As I mentioned, we've got 80 seats in the Anthony's Coal Fired and 50 for Chipotle. Parking has been recalculated on the site. When Matt Grill was here, they had 252 seats. We have reduced that by 122 seats, so there's a total of 130 internal seats. We've also added the mezzanine conversion, which I'll talk about shortly. When we do the analysis, we have 313 spaces that we're required to provide, and there are 315 spaces on the property. And this is a survey that was provided to demonstrate the existing as-built locations of the parking spaces. So this is the location of the mezzanine. This is a conversion of what currently is Golfsmith's mezzanine. It's not being utilized. So it will be taken back and converted to commercial use. Ralph will talk more about the architectural elements, but it will be there'll essentially be a standing seam canopy, two entrances, a double entrance, and a single entrance to the stairs. In this location, this will enter into an elevator lobby for the employees to get to the second level where the space will be located. There is a floor plan in your packets as well. In addition, there'll be some additional windows added, landscaping along the front, in addition to a 5-foot sidewalk to provide for better access for the employees to the space. It really activates the back of the space and takes space that's not being effectively utilized and utilizing it for commercial purposes. This is the floor plan here. You can see the blowing it up. Thank you very much. This is the mezzanine level where the office space will be located. The commercial space will be located. Here's the elevator. Down below that up here is the entry level, floor level, which will, as I mentioned, have the single access to the stairs and then the double entrance into the elevator lobby, which will be created. There's a total of, I believe, 5,492 square feet that's going to be put into use and which has been provided in the parking tabulations. More on the elevation shortly. Another component of the package is the OIA is looking to do an outdoor patio. Based on code requirements, they would be permitted up to 13 seats on that patio. They will provide a railing system for that, the patio, that will be that will match the black metal railing at Starbucks. The tenant will be required to seek approval from the selectmen as part of their liquor license prior to the incorporation of this patio. Adequate egress clearances are provided along the existing sidewalk for so that the pedestrians and ADA compliance will be met with the installation of the railings. A couple other things I didn't mention. On the patio for Anthony's Coal Fired Grill, they will have umbrellas. They will also have an awning. The awning system will be a canvas awning. That will have, they will also have fans and LED lighting that will be below, underneath the awnings. They've also coordinated with the health department. They will be providing an air curtain at the bar opening where you have the 6 seats at the bar open to the air. We also are one other sign component to the application. I apologize. There's a modification to the existing sign, freestanding sign. We'll show you shortly. Thanks,
next Tuesday.
And this whoops. This, with the addition of some additional tenants, we went from one tenant in the macro space to three tenants. Signage is an important element for these tenants, so we're proposing two panels to be added to this existing sign. You can see the nighttime view as well as the opaque background is required by zoning. And we each panel is 8.7 square feet, and that is also part of your packages as well. I think that covers all the major issues, and with that, I'd like to turn it over to Ralph Coppola to talk a little bit about the architecture.
Which plan would you like?
I think the exterior elevation. What we've tried to do is to match the architecture on.
Oh, it's a little black button. That's right.
Okay. The rest of the mall, right now, when this was Macaroni Grill, they had kind of an arched top. We've tried to straighten this out and bring in the same stucco colors that are on the rest of the mall. And then opening up the storefronts and create the same pier, stone piers, neutral piers, and they're going to strip off the old stone that was on for Macaroni Grill and match the rest of the shopping center. So we've tried to get this all to blend in a little bit more with the rest of the shopping center. As it comes around, they kept the arch here in the storefront. They have an awning over here for the bar, and same thing here. We're going to continue and make all the stonework match so it all is consistent. Along with the ephes and repainting it, the mezzanine that we're adding on, we redid the entrance on that, and we follow the same color scheme of the paints and the stucco on that. If you could put the missing elevation. So, because of the existing building's two-story height, we've added in a little metal roof so that we can keep the scale down and use that as a demarcation of the two different paint colors, and then this new entrance storefront into the elevator so that the tenants can use this. And then this door, which is solid right now, we're going to open this up with a glass door so it's more inviting, and we try to add some landscaping. And at the base of this building right now, which is going to add the stonework in also to help blend in with the rest of the mall. And we wrap that around to the back side along here, so it just, again, just carries some more consistency. Punched in a couple windows in this elevation, did some signage with a couple little lights here, and we'll have some soffit lights in underneath the little roof overhang. We have these windows that are already we'll add a couple more windows there, and that will pretty well take care of the mezzanine space.
Hey, Ralph, I'd like to mention about this. This is space that currently exists. It was, in fact, the Linens and Things was the original tenant. They went bankrupt before Golf Town took over, and they actually used the space for offices up there.
Yes,
it isn't new space. It's space that's there that we're trying to redo and make more attractive.
When Golf Town was there originally, they used that as their training center when they were coming to the U.S. because I did all their locations. And then now Golfsmith does not need that space, so that's why we're trying to utilize this so that we can dress this up. Right now, it just does not have, you know, the curb appeal, and we really want to dress this area up and make it more inviting. So. Once we add this in, we have some material samples here. So that this would be the stone that's matching the existing new metal roof. These are the paint colors that would be used on the mezzanine and also along the front of the building. So try to keep a little bit more consistency with the rest of the mall. We do have some light fixtures, cuts that we can leave with you on what was selected for the mezzanine, but we have not got all the light fixtures worked out with Anthony's and the other tenants. Once we do have those, then we can add that into the package. Do you want to address the landscaping?
The landscaping by Anthony's. Right now, it's, if you've driven up there, and I drove up there before I came over here again tonight, it's pretty attractive. That's a good picture of it. So we're going to simply reconfigure the landscaping. We will give Jesse a plan how we're going to reconfigure. We're going to reconfigure that plan because that's now going to be in part the outside patio area. So we have existing landscaping. We're just going to move it around to best suit what needs to be done there. The other thing, Ralph, just so everybody knows, if we go back to the other picture that one right there. This is the area that's going to have a front door and an entrance area right there. So I wanted to make sure everybody was clear on that. It wasn't the back side. That actually faces the Home Depot store, and the rest of it is the back of the center. But that long facade is the one that will have the storefront entrance, the doors, where we're actually turning the elevator around. There is an elevator in there that it was used by Linens and Things. We're turning the elevator around and creating the elevator lobby right there where the elevator is located. And then using the other one as the egress. So there'll be a small space in the first floor for entering. That's where Ralph has designed the canopy. So it'll really take something that's kind of an ugly duckling and make it pretty attractive.
Anything else to cover?
I think we've addressed most of the comments that were raised previously. I'm more than glad to answer anything else that you have.
Sure.
Thank you.
All right, well, maybe we start with that and we can go through this. A couple of memos in here. Quick glance, it seems like a lot of these questions, comments have been addressed, but do you have any questions from the board?
Well, just a little bit of, I'm pretty sure I understand what they're proposing. So on the, what is currently the front from the macaroni space, will the fake roof and the pylons supporting the fake roof are all going to go away. And that'll be the, basically a flat faced, similar to the adjacent thing. You're planning on keeping the arches or refenestration? I guess you're going to change the windows there.
Yeah, they're going to keep this arch.
Keep that one, but I meant
we're going to strip off this stone.
Mm-hmm.
Build this up here, so square it off.
Oh, square it off anyway. Yeah.
Right now, because it's too identifiable with that,
right.
It just doesn't blend with the rest of it. So this is what we came up with to help blend in and make a tower on that corner of the building, which will help anchor some identity to the mall. Because right now, Mac Road is just basic for their signage, but once we put this up there, you'll have a better identity, which blends in with the rest of the mall.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking about the existing windows for Macaroni are arched under that roof. So that whole facade is going to be redone.
This is going to stay.
Yeah.
They're just going to put
But
in,
the ones to the
yeah,
left.
We're going to put glass in there. These are going to be, those are going to be taken out.
Right.
This is coming off.
Right.
Stripping it all back,
okay.
That whole section.
But you plan to maintain the, like in front of the corner of the Verizon and the Golfsmith, you've got basically the false stone halfway up and then a pilaster which continues up to the roof line. You can reproduce that in the new space?
Yes, all of these are going to be carried along.
That makes sense. Yeah, well, the materials you'll take care of, that I know.
The reason it was done the way it ended up being done was because originally this was a groundlet, and Macaroni Grill actually built the road. And so they had their prototype, which had that particular look, which was part of their identifying elements. So we really couldn't tell them what to do. We needed your approval. But we think this is a much better solution because it really ties it into the rest of the center with the stacked stone and so forth.
So along the side of the building where you're going to put the patio and the through the wall bar seats, you're expanding or widening that pavement of a certain amount?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's an angled piece that was cut back to square off.
Right, okay.
What's your vision for that mezzanine? Are you planning on doing, I mean, it's going to be like professional services, like a lawyer's offices, or will it actually be a commercial space?
It probably won't be lawyer's offices unless we can get Brad to move over there. it's not really kind of, it's still sort of, it's the side of, back of the shopping center, so it's a lesser rent kind of office user that may, you know, may like the location, you know, and we don't have a tenant for it yet, or we would be, like, we've identified who the other tenants are, so it's kind of on speculation on our part. It could be a commercial tenant that may have a retail bent to it. I don't know what that is, you know, specifically, but it definitely could be a retail tenant that doesn't have to be along the main front that needs a retail kind of location.
It might be a manufacturer's rep that would be an ideal kind of a use.
Yeah.
So
could be office.
Sure.
Yeah.
Can we go over the seating count again? The Anthony's is 80 seats. Is it 80 seats plus the 22 that are outside?
Correct.
At some point, there could be 102.
Seasonally.
But at some point. Well, seasonally, all the patios will be occupied, so there's 13 more for Oyes, potentially.
Yep.
And Chipotle's is 50 plus 10. All right, so these numbers, does the parking show that max number?
Does not include the patio seating. The indication was that patio seating does not have to be counted toward the parking count because it's seasonal.
But can you say the total seats we have now, even with the outdoor seats, are going to be less than
Macaroni
Grill?
Right.
Yeah,
correct.
That's what I was trying to get at.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
I was trying to do the numbers so that we can still
absolutely
see that it's less than the total.
It is less.
Yeah, it's 256 seats, I
think. But when you add in the square footage from the other space. I know there's less seats, but you're adding in more retail space.
Yeah, non-restaurant space.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right, so that's the number we need to figure out. You're saying it's 156 seats, potentially maxed out. Plus the mezzanine, plus the hair salon. The hair salon's only four seats. Four seats.
Yeah, that's space.
It's all about space, really. As long as we have the right number of spaces, I hope everything will be proposed.
The seat count would be reduced from the current macro from 122, I think 96. Is that right? If some of the patio seats are included.
Well, Mac Grill had three. How many seats?
252.
Okay, so we're still down 96 seats.
Mezzanine space adds back a requirement. Mm-hmm. It probably won't generate a lot of spaces when it was there because you won't have a lot of retail traffic going there, I don't think. But it does generate the need to have additional parking spaces.
Yeah, it's in that chart.
It's in the chart.
Yeah.
There's also, didn't you come before us to do some changes to Staples? I think you're going to add another space in there.
Well, they yes. cut back on the space that Staples is using, yeah.
Right, but they did that to carve out another, it's been a while, so I don't know if that's another
retail
space.
That's a good memory. I don't know, Ralph, do you want to address it?
Yeah. that Staples decided not to downsize.
Oh, they did, okay.
So they stayed, and the restaurant that was going to go in there is the Anthony's that's going to the corner.
So
that's why everything was started moving around, and then that's when we decided, wait a second, we have to just look at this whole macaroni grill situation, then bring it all in as one package for you. So that was part of the conflict that we were running into, was that we got in front of you last year for that mezzanine space and Staples, and they were supposed to downsize, and then they finally decided to keep the store the same size and not do it. And then Mark had another tenant, the Macaroni Grill, was going to leave, and that's why we finally got to where we are today.
We had, actually, I think I met with Jesse maybe a year and a half ago, maybe at least, on the mezzanine plan. And I don't know if any of you folks know about this. Well, this mezzanine plan was done, we were looking at the plan, probably a good year and a half ago. But then we realized Staples was downsizing, at least we thought they were, and Macaroni Grill was about to go dark. And we said, we got to do all this at once. We can't go in piecemeal because it's too crazy to keep track of it all. And actually, Jesse and Gene both suggested that would be a better way of doing it, too. So so as we finally got to the point where Ralph actually drew plans, came before you, actually representing Staples, to do the downsizing, and then they changed their mind. And we had a lease with Macaroni Grill for the downsized space.
Anthony's
for the downsized space. We actually had architectural work done, all the legal work done. I mean, we spent a lot of money trying to do the downsizing for Staples, and then they said, no, we want to stay. And we had to go back to the beginning. So we're finally there, we hope.
So does this approval tonight undo? I guess I'm looking at just, does it undo? Does it matter?
No, we could add in a finding to the decision, sort of stating that the previously approved, I think that was a minor mod as well. You know, it's no longer
maybe just
applicable.
Kind of or you trace know. The dots if anyone ever feels inclined.
If I remember, the Staples was basically carving off one side of the
right.
In off-shaped side, but I don't think it was necessarily on this side. It wasn't towards Goldsmith. It was on the other.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it was the other side.
So I mean, there's no conflict between this and the previous plan.
Well, I know. I guess I'm just thinking if anyone feels inclined to kind of trace the dots, keep track of the changes.
Well, if Staples, you know, goes back to their previous thought and downsizes, then that previous plan was still.
That's true.
Still works and it's still in effect.
Yeah. No, they're down spaces now.
They'll be down.
They'll be down
spaces.
They'll be down in total spaces. They'll have to deal with the number of spaces, parking spaces.
Right.
Can't go back to the original Staples plan with this in place.
No, because of parking.
If it stays with retail.
If it stays retail and not, it would not be a restaurant. We would not. So we could do a retail store there that had the same parking requirements as Staples. So I think for that reason, it's a good reason that they change.
Am I doing the numbers wrong? I show them being down one space according to this table. If you add in all of the patio seating, they're down one space. You need 316, and you're saying there are 315. If you put more retail in, unless the retail's already included in here.
Well,
yeah,
yeah,
it's
just
saying
that
they downsize Staples. So
yeah,
it would still be the same
Staples
square footage.
Space to some other retail space. So
it'd be two retail spaces.
We just couldn't do a restaurant.
Yeah.
Right.
We have enough restaurants. We think we have the right balance of restaurants right now.
Apples to apples, if the
I have another question on parking. So you're adding restaurants, which is ideally probably going to increase the car count. There seems to be a lack of handicap spaces in that area. Being a family member who, having a family member who just lost a leg, who I have to push around in a wheelchair, it's a serious concern moving him around. To go to any one of those restaurants is a complete nightmare. There's only two handicap spots.
If you look in the whole parking field, there's a lot of handicap spaces, and they're the only ones that don't get
I'm sorry?
If you look in the entire parking field, not just there, there are a lot of parking, there are a lot of handicap parking spaces, and very seldom are they used. And I, like you, had a handicapped mother who was in a wheelchair for 10 years, and I did the same thing that you did. So I'm very sensitive to the same thing, but we meet code, and we meet the demand, too. We really do. The spaces that are not used all the time are the handicap spaces.
Have you talked about shifting those handicap spaces at all? Are you putting them right to the corner?
No, I don't.
One in, and I can supply it for it.
And the one that we're moving is only to accommodate. It's not a code issue. We need code. It's really a request by the police chief to move it. He'd like it better over there than he did where it was.
Yeah, it wasn't a bad location. But are you still going to do the same sort of double ramp with a step down from the edge, or are you going to have a traditional curb cut?
Traditional curb cut. No. I'm going to do a traditional curb cut like the rest of the center.
Okay. Just make sure you have enough. Make sure you have at least 4 feet off the flare to the corner of the Chipotle patio.
It's going to shift one spot down, so this would essentially be the access out now, so that you'll have all that space in there.
Yeah, it's this side here.
Yeah, but it would be a traditional curb cut now, so it won't have that flare up each way. It'll just have a flare thing with flares.
That's not a flare, that's a ramp. That's a flare.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. That's where I'm going
to
put it.
So you need to have 4 feet off of that.
Yep.
And so that's what I'm saying.
That's why we're
as you
move
approach
it down.
The corner of the patio, just make sure you have at least 4 feet there.
Yeah, and that's why we talked about shifting this all down.
Mm-hmm. But you said only one space.
Yeah, this will shift to here. And the access will come in here. I'll provide it all in plan dimensioned.
Okay.
You don't think it's enough space, Nick?
No, I don't think it's close. I don't think it's 8 feet. I think it's maybe 5 feet. You center the curb cut on the rightmost handicap space,
uh-huh.
And it's 4 feet deep, uh-huh. And then you have the side wing flare.
Uh-huh.
That's going to come back to almost where that right ramp starts in its upper left corner. And from there to the Chipotle patio is about 4 feet, half of one of those spaces. Right?
Here.
Not
to
draw it, but
right there. That's about 4 feet. So can you get this guy here?
But this, which one second, I don't want to over inject, but if this comes down here, this will become centered. It won't become where this ramp is. It will become centered on this position because it doesn't need to go the whole 8 feet. It only needs to go the 5 feet.
I'll draw it for you. This is where you want to put it, right there, right? Right? That flare.
I understand it has to be 4 feet.
That's
that
the
corner.
Distance.
Yep.
So it's close. It's
yep.
Not, generous. It's close.
Yeah.
That's all.
Okay.
Don't present it like it's 10 feet. It's not.
No. I'm not presenting it like it's 10 feet. I was just trying to get clarification.
So Nick, do you think this is gonna work?
It should work, but I'm just saying it's just enough space. I don't think it's a lot of space. I mean, if you went over one more, I don't know if that helped. But when you lay it out, if you've got the 4 feet, 5 feet, you're all set. But if it's tight, you may need to shift over one more space.
Yeah. I mean, the space is there, but it's a matter of be careful.
Yes.
Yeah. And what about, are you guys going to have to change your snow removal plan? Because right now, I think you were piling it up in the lot. And it was taking up a lot of spaces.
That's a great question. The answer is probably yes. We'll know next year depending on how much snow we have. This year, we didn't have to, despite the amount of snow, because of the fact that McLean Hill was closed.
Right.
So we weren't using the entire parking lot. So now that the whole place will be tenanted, it will, you know, the spaces will be filling up. There's always been, even when Macron Grill was there, Linda's of things, grand opening, we always had enough parking spaces. Couldn't always park in front of the store you may want to go to, you have to park in the corner. But there was always enough parking spaces. We expect that we'll be here when we're all done here also. But the snow question is a good one. And if we don't have enough spaces and we need to move the snow to Vanzola, we'll move it. We do it all the time.
A couple of questions, yeah. Unless I'm missing it, maybe it was included. Details on the awning for Anthony's. There's going to be an awning over the bar that sticks out, right?
Yes.
Did we have any detail? Maybe you can provide anything on that?
Yeah, it should be in the package.
I kept looking. Do you guys see it?
As far as materials or whether it's seasonal?
What's that?
What the material is and whether it's seasonal?
Yeah, what is it? Where is it? What is it going to be made out of? What are the dimensions?
No. It's a canvas awning.
Black.
Got umbrella.
Sunbrella.
And Mr. Weston, the bar does not protrude outside the lease line. The stools may be sitting out there in season, but the bar does not protrude out.
Okay, that was the other thing. Because you can't tell from
right.
the plan here. So, in the winter, you're going to see glass of windows that are closed.
Yeah.
In the summer, when the store is open, when the restaurant's open, those are going to be open. There will be stools there looking into the bar.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Under an awning that sticks out.
Under the awning.
Okay. Awnings there, just like all the rest of the awnings, canvas is going to be there all the time. It's not retractable or anything, right?
Yeah, it's not retractable. It'll be a fixed awning.
There's space enough between the awning and where the umbrellas are going? There's umbrellas over the tables, right?
No, I think.
They forgoes the umbrella of the screen, the air screen that we're providing, so they won't have an awning and the lights.
The seats out in the on the patio, there's not going to be any umbrellas over them.
The awning will be here, and they have some other tables down here which could have umbrellas on them.
How far out does the awning extend?
This one?
The elevation shows an awning that extends almost the width of the patio, I thought. The length of the patio, I thought it was the width of the patio. It's not shown on the front elevation. See, like from that elevation there, you don't see the awning we're talking about. On the front.
Right.
You do a little bit on the upper one. I'm not sure it's
that's
correct.
No, I think that's just the entrance.
Yeah. The entrance. Okay.
Yeah.
You don't see it.
This is an angled awning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How far off does it? Does it come right up to the fence line?
No, I'm trying to check on
it. Yeah, that's what I was trying to explain. From the last meeting that we had about a screen wall, they had changed from umbrellas to forego and have a full awning that extends out to provide a screen for the whole open air screen.
Okay.
So the whole awning would extend out and it will be provided with those fans and LED lights.
Okay. Will you have post supports on the end of that
screen?
Yes, there are.
Okay.
Have to have
and that's all permanent. You're not going to take it out in the winter.
No.
So there's LED lights underneath the awning sticking out some 6 feet, 8 feet off the side of the building.
I think they're going to be in the fans.
They're in the fan. They're
in the fans.
With the fan.
Down lights in the fan, I think. Yeah, I mean, part of this is the coordination with us and the other things.
No,
talking about this?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Optional LED lights over here.
That can't be enough lighting to afford this.
What was that?
That can't be enough lighting for the seating area. Just the Haiku LED ring at the bottom of the fan.
Anthony's will be evaluating the lighting to make sure that there's proper coverage there. And as part of their building permit package, you know, they will, if they have to add additional lighting, we'll have to, they'll be coming back to you for signage on the side as well. So they'll probably provide you with any additional details or changes that may occur as part of that construction document package. Mm-hmm. Right now, they feel they only need the three that are shown.
I think we should just stick a condition into that any additional lighting would come back, but it should be up in the awning, you know, not hung from the rim of the awning. So they can light it, but it would
it is
be up high so that you wouldn't be seeing all the light sources.
You're saying that is a condition so they don't have to come back? Is that what you said?
Well, if they want to.
Could condition it so that then they could go through Jesse or something.
Yeah, I mean, the lighting as a whole for the site wasn't really included in this package, so you know I had drafted a condition for all site lighting, so we can include it in that. I guess my question back to the board is: are they going to be comfortable with that? We know there's been a lot of history with the site and lighting.
This lighting isn't going to detract
not under the canopy, but you know the series of wall packs they have proposed on the side of the building and the other lighting, really. I'm less concerned about this, but.
Yeah. I mean, the lighting that they're proposing here is basically the 800 lumen LED per fan, which is basically a 60-watt bulb, a bright 60-watt, which, you know, underneath is no big deal.
Yeah.
We've also got the commercial air curtains, and we've got the, is this an outdoor heater, or is this part of the air curtain?
There are no outdoor heaters proposed.
What's that called?
Mars.
It's part of the air curtain.
It's unheated, Dave.
Okay. Yeah. Got it.
Is that a local requirement? Because I walk by restaurants in Boston all the time. They swing their windows wide open. They don't have any air curtains.
Right. It's our local.
The interpretation.
It's the interpretation of the health code and some communities have it different. We've always taken the stance that you need an air curtain or screens.
So can I just be clear, because it's not clear on this, these plans. The awning is going over the entire patio, so the awning is going to cover that entire 550 square feet of the patio.
Yes, Anthony's made a change during the conversations with Board of Health, and we had already submitted somebody's package, so that's why
I just want to make sure that we're
approving
what we're approving,
right?
Because that I get that it's not good or bad, but it definitely is. It's sort of a different perspective of what's happening along that street edge.
Mm-hmm.
It's extending the building out. It's sort of nice, but it's a different look than anything that's been shown here.
Well, the side elevation,
that shows it.
Right.
You know, it's exposure for them to all the traffic that goes to Jordan's and Home Depot.
That's the way it's showing it. Yeah, I mean, like I said, not good, not bad, just different,
So, and these little squares on the elevation, those are the lighting, right? Those lighting?
Well, people will have the same existing downlight wall packs that are on the center right now. We're just going back there. This is exactly what we're going to do is, like I talked to you, I would present any light specs with the construction documents.
Yeah, just we have to go back.
But there's no lights there now.
Yeah.
because the restaurant has that sort of arcaded canopied gooseneck things.
Those decorative downlights that come on the side of the building.
On that side, but not where you're putting the canopy. Canopy just has those goosenecks.
Yeah, that's what we were talking about, if we were going to extend the existing lights to carry across, or if anybody wants us to change it up. So, as I talked to Jesse about a condition of providing the lights, as a spec for what we're going to use for them.
So that's the same number of lights. How many goosenecks are there right now? Five plus that small sign, if that's really there. A couple of those lanterns at the entrance.
There's seven here, 10 plus that sign. So.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. There's eight here, so yeah, it's about the same.
Okay.
For OAAs, is that going to be, are they going to have umbrellas, awnings, or?
I believe that's umbrellas.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do we have more?
He hasn't designed it yet.
Okay. He has to come back.
There are a couple of almost like benches that are built into the facade at OAAs. How are those going to be addressed with the patio?
Extra seats. So.
Well, I mean, you're showing the seating kind of going right up to the glass, so.
No question. So we'd want to condition that, I would assume. Well, you don't really see them in that plan, do you?
It looks like they've been removed by the plan.
They've been removed.
I think you need to remove them so that you have flexibility with the table layouts in there. Nobody wants to sit on
probably
that.
Probably screen a hazard anyways.
We will. I'm just conditioning more details on the design is completed. So the way it is set.
The fences on all these are like the ones on Starbucks. The ones in Starbucks come, they take that down during the winter, or was that up all winter?
I think it was up all winter.
And so it's a plan that all these fences stay up all winter?
As far as I know. Well, you know.
Starbucks is bolted down.
Yeah, I think they're all bolted down.
Mm-hmm.
And these will match.
Yeah, well, Starbucks will match OEAs, and Chipotle will have their own motif, this stuff. And then Anthony's will have their own. Anthony's and Chipotle don't aren't next to each other. I mean, they're next to each other, but they're not. Right.
Okay.
There should be example pictures in there.
And I guess snow clearing and walking and on the sidewalks and everything. Do you all the snow clearing?
Right.
You
do.
So this is what Chipotle is looks like. And then we have this is going to be Anthony's.
Anthony's is the same as the Starbucks one, it's just not black, if that's the
right.
The color.
and OAA's will be the same as Starbucks.
And they will be bolted down? Is that what you're saying?
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's see, I know there's some memos here from town engineer, police chief, and yourself. It seems like the comment from the town engineer, and I think the comments from the police chief have been addressed.
Yeah. Yeah, so what we'd want to see is the revised ramp drawing, and we'll run it by the town engineer.
Josh, I have a question for you. Did the police chief or the town engineer have any safety concerns with that four-way intersection between the Anthony's and the Home Depot? It's a pretty busy, rather crazy intersection now.
And that's a one thing I was going to add is that, you know, Chipotle is going to draw out. Your parking is required is what it's going to require, but the turnover and the frequency, and it's going to be a much busier parking lot, and certainly a much younger clientele, high school kids, lots of high school kids. And so, you know, I know already that this section of the parking lot fills up. It fills up right now.
Actually, it's the largest part of the parking lot.
No, I know it's the largest part, but that section as compared to over to Home Depot or
stuff,
that section. So it's likely that at some point kids are going to end up parking over on the other side of that intersection. Question is, has there, I know from an automobile driver perspective, that's a tough spot because people stop that aren't supposed to stop. And I'm just wondering, has there been any pedestrian issues there?
There was nothing that the chief reported. He actually says that this is a pretty well-operated shopping center as a whole. They really haven't had too many issues. So, you know, I don't think he was overly concerned. He didn't mention it. We did hold a DRT, and there was nothing that was brought to our attention from him regarding that. You know, we did bring up the issue with the sidewalk. If, you know, there's going to be additional employees parked at the back of the mezzanine to sort of create that connection there. That's specifically related to the intersection, though.
Yeah, one of the things that came up when you were talking about the complete streets plan, and they did the pedestrian analysis in like the downtown area, the striped section in the center of the three lane, if that were a raised island, if there was an opportunity for a mid safety island.
In between here.
To shorten that crosswalk.
Personally, I wouldn't want to create an issue where there isn't one, but I would really like some reassurance that if this becomes an issue, that you all are willing to investigate things like that, because I would be surprised if it doesn't become an issue.
If it became a problem, we would definitely pursue the solution.
Maybe others want it for, you know, them to address the issue.
It would be very difficult right now to put that in there because of the width of the
Well, yeah, even if it were one of like the downtown, the brick raised crosswalks, it's gives both the visual and a little bit of the tactile as you drive past it. I mean, it's something that not intrusive, but that might make a big difference. To be considered.
My point is actually that picture right there, Jesse, with the car kind of right and left, and everyone's kind of going in different directions, and cars run left.
Yeah, I mean, it is a challenging intersection if you're trying to go from, like, Starbucks to Home Depot, if you're trying to make that cross, you know.
Right. It is, you know, I've been caught there myself several times.
Challenging, yeah.
Okay. There's a whole lot we can do about that right now. If she feels that it's currently well maintained, I guess we ask that we keep an eye on it, and if the situation arises, we would address it together. Your memo, Jesse. Has the applicant addressed all of your questions?
So there's a few things. The building inspector has had some challenges with some unpermitted structures at the back of this foyer space. I don't know if I can get any views back there, but there's a number of structures that were not permitted, and he has some severe concerns with that. So this has been going on for, I would say, at least a year, maybe a little bit longer. We did ask for them to really take a look at it. Since we amended our zoning, we do allow for a little bit more flexibility with what they're looking for. Currently, there's a storage container back there, and we do allow a special permit by the CPDC to allow for a storage container. So they certainly have the ability now to seek that approval. Before, it really just wasn't allowed at all. So that's an option that they can look into. The other sort of structures that they've constructed without a permit relate to sort of these lean-to overhangs for OEAs to add some additional storage space. Those are actually affixed to the building, if I'm not mistaken.
One's fixed to the building.
So the building inspector has asked that those be addressed, and he's been trying to get them to do it for some time now. And, you know, I did bring it up here. I don't know if you want to address it tonight.
Well, first, I think Kelly, you can address it. Kelly, one of the structures is coming down the end of the week, right?
Correct.
So it's coming down the end of the week. But I think Jesse had a good, this is something we didn't do. This is something that Kevin Lorenzoye did without permission from us. And I think he thought it was pretty innocuous. It was a very small structure. He doesn't understand, he doesn't speak great English, quite frankly. And he doesn't probably always understand the rules, but he's a terrific restaurateur and a very nice man. And he's agreed he will take this down. By the end of the week, he's been working with Kelly. The other structure that could be permitted through the CPDC, but he needs to make application, he would like to have enough time to permit that. So the, assuming we're good, he's good, if we're good to our word, that it will be coming down within a week or so, that we would like to have our certificate of occupancy, not the building permit, Jesse, if possible, because we might be in for a building permit in a month, but it might take him 3 months or 4 months to actually go through his permitting process. But if we could tie our certificate of occupancy to satisfying the requirement of either removing the structure or having it properly permitted, that would be great. That was possible.
And then, so there's the structure that you're talking about getting permitted. Is that a storage container? Is that something that's attached to the building?
The one that's attached to the building is coming down.
Okay.
The one that is not attached, that'd like to be he wants to file an application to allow that as an accessory structure through the appropriate process, as well as the storage container.
So it's the storage container and the other accessory structure that's freestanding?
It's detached.
And then there's also the trailer that's back there from the paper store, I believe, right?
Yeah. Is that what I didn't know that was still an issue.
Yeah, I didn't realize that was still an issue.
We'll have to do whatever we have to do there. The paper store, they're a great tenant, and I didn't know that problem hadn't been addressed.
Well, I think the concern is that it stays there consistently. It doesn't move. It's to our building inspector, a structure. Not mm-hmm. serving its purpose as a voting facility.
Would the accessory structure process be an option there if we reach out to the paper store?
That's something we'd have to look into. If it's being held as storage, I think the bylaw allows for temporary storage container.
So is this like a delivery trailer that they?
Yeah, I think it moves occasionally, but it's there a lot.
It's probably like the one at the Home Goods.
Yeah.
I mean, the trailer, which is just, it's parked there.
Oh, yeah, Goodwill. It's at the loading dock where you'd expect it to be. It's at the loading dock. And I do think it moves, you know, occasionally, but it's there a lot. So,
okay. So you can apply for a special permit, it sounds like, a truck trailer used for storage or advertising. You can apply to the CPDC, so you'll want to address all of those structures through the
right fees. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we could tie our certificate of occupancy for the Macaroni Grill reuse to having properly handled through either CPDC getting permits or tearing that or removing.
So what is your timeline for that project?
We want to be in here ASAP with a demolition permit application. And then Ralph has been, we've released them to go ahead with the construction drawings. And the biggest coordination right now is the electric, as you can tell, is really the electrical issues. But we know what the demising walls are. We know what the exterior materials are. So they're going. I'm hoping he can be back here in a month or so with the documents that we can get moving on.
And then beyond that, the tenants come in.
Well,
they'll be
right
coming in
that.
Soon to do their additional fit-up work beyond what we're doing for the initial breakup and facade work.
We need to move because the space has been vacant now for so long, it's starting to hurt.
I guess I want to make sure that we're not going to be at the end of the line where, it's probably going to be a 4 to 6 week process. You have to advertise for the special permit. So the timing, I just wouldn't want to be at that end where Anthony's, I'm assuming their build out is, how long is there?
Probably 120 days from the time we turn over to them.
But Jesse, that's why I suggested we just don't tie it to the building permit, but to the CFO.
That's what I'm saying. If we get to the point of the CFO and it's still not addressed in a timely fashion, then it's really hard on us to deny that occupancy when they're saying we got to open. And we have this outstanding issue, which we've had for a year and a half, almost 2 years.
Would it be within 90 days? That would give a chance to get the package together, get it filed, get on the agenda, the schedule, get the decision, have the appeal relapse.
Might I suggest that, in the case of the Oyes, we have an opportunity because we could condition the patio and the rest of their work on solving the issues in the back of the building.
We could, but I think the building inspector just is, at this point, he doesn't really want to issue any permits until this has been resolved.
It's the attached structure that's the problem, because he doesn't want to issue a building permit to a building that's in violation.
That's coming down.
Right,
that's
so
coming
if that's gone, then the accessory structures don't preclude him from issuing a building permit. And so then you could go David's route, kind of, sort of.
We're also adding square footage to the property by doing this, correct?
No.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Do you folks charge your rent on those accessory structures?
No.
No.
You sure? They're not very big. They're probably four square. How big are they?
Yeah, they're probably 10 square feet. Maybe less.
Yeah.
So if we can have the permanent structure taken down within a week.
Cleaned, right. Cleared off.
And we'd want to have confirmation of that.
Yeah, I think ultimately everything resolved. I mean, I think, the CPDC can certainly put it as a condition for occupancy, but I can't say one way or another if he's going to go along with that. I would like to say that would probably make a pretty good case, it's really...
Well, actually, if the attached structure is part of the demolition package, they can apply for the permit. They can apply for the demo permit.
Right.
Correct.
That's a good approach. Just basically require that the existing non-conforming structures be included in the demolition permit request.
There's still that freestanding structure in the storage container, though, that aren't properly permitted.
And then we can tie those to the patio.
I would say just tie it to the occupancy.
Okay.
If that's what the board is comfortable with.
the...
Their tenants sound anxious. I think they're going to move a lot faster than some of the other restaurants we've had. I just, I don't want to be in the position that Jesse's talking about, where we look like the bad guy.
I'd rather limit it to just, well, the challenge is if the paper store, they've got a structure as well. Can we tie that to OEA's as well?
The challenge is if OEA's, for some reason, just foregoes their patio, then we have nothing to go with. And then...
That's a good point.
Mm, okay.
No, but certainly if the paper store, if the paper store is in non-compliance, then you can tie them being in compliance to the issuance of the certificate of occupancy for the rest of the center. That's fair. It's time to resolve that. I mean, tomorrow we'll be on the phone to paper store saying you've got to apply the new provision of the zoning that allows you to go to the CPDC to get a permit to do this.
So you're going to leave it up to the paper store to do that?
I think they should be the lead on it. We'll be involved in it.
Yeah.
I think they should be the lead. They know what they need to do. They may come back and say, we move that thing every week. Maybe doesn't need to be permanent. Maybe something, I don't know. My guess is it does. But if the thing moves every other day, then it probably doesn't. Then it's a trailer. So I think they should. I think they should be in charge of that.
Okay.
Is the trigger that the applicant is the application is made? Because once the application is made for the approval, it's going to take its own course, whether it's approved or rejected. Is it the outcome has to be resolved by that point, or just that request has been made and is in process?
I think we would like to have an outcome.
Yeah, I would agree.
I mean, where do I have it drafted in here? I would say that if you want to, I mean, it has to be all structures. I really don't want to break it up. Paper store, OEA's. I want to say just for the site, because I know how long we chased down paper store to fix that sign.
Yeah.
You know, it's just.
They did fix it.
They did. A couple years, 2 years later. But I certainly would be amenable to tying it to the occupancy permit. I think that would give you enough time.
I think so too.
And if not, I mean, June 22nd, we're here and everybody's here, and I think you'll have enough time to do it at that point.
Yeah,
okay.
All right. Is that everything in your memo, Jesse?
Yeah, I believe so.
Not more, but there was one issue that wasn't really resolved, and one that, you know, I don't think that, you know, as the way that Nick calculated it, and assuming that his calculations are right, that got one short one space when you count the outdoor spaces as seats, which I'm not sure how you can. For parking, I mean, they're going to be open. I think we've always come back. It's counted those.
I don't think I've ever seen it broken out. Because even Venetian, for example, when they were coming in with their roof terrace, they were taking seating from inside and moving it outside.
Yeah,
they were never increasing the
count. But they're exempt from...
I know, but we talked about that. We talked about total seat count, and we were trying to figure it out.
I mean, I'm not sure that the building inspector actually considers it as permanent seating for zoning purposes. He does require all the plumbing codes to be met. But
I mean, it's only one space, so...
Well, if you...
If there's no rule that says...
If we're looking at it, did you guys include Starbucks? Then you're probably over a couple more spaces.
Starbucks exterior?
Starbucks exterior, yeah.
We sort of had a ruling before for the building for the same work count.
Yeah, I don't think he counts.
Yeah, he asked us just to count all the plumbing fixtures for anyone who we're adding to make sure that the plumbing fixtures are adequate or added seats.
So the building inspector is now defining how we...
Don't go there.
I am.
We'll resolve it in parking.
What's that? It's about parking. It's about how many people are going to use a space on a site. It's not a building inspector issue.
It's not been requested, but of course the area that we're talking about, that was the mezzanine, is an office use, and I know that you're dealing with shared parking. That office use would not be consistent with any intensive restaurant use, so that those spaces behind the building really would be available for, say, employees on the evening shift for a restaurant. So there could be an arrangement worked out there, by the way, if there's one shy, to have that be a resolution.
Which seems to make sense to me, but I think that I would, it's my feeling that you need to make that case, because I don't think that, I don't like going down the road saying that seasonal, outdoor seating is not part of parking requirements. I don't think that's the way that this board has looked at that in the past, so I'm not sure why we started. That being said, I think there's probably ways that you can do it. Maybe it's one less table. Maybe it's committing to, not using all the spaces, all the seats inside. I mean, I don't know how this ties into restaurant occupancy. Code-wise, I mean, if it's the same, I know that was an issue for Grumpy's.
He certainly looks at it from the number of fixtures from the plumbing code. As far as occupancy, I'm not quite sure what he requests.
Because I know with Grumpy's, their building occupancy was, they did the same thing, that they tied the max number of seats that they were allowed with the outdoor seating.
So let's start. I agree with John that I think outdoor seating should be accounted for. And is this, are we considering a condition? Say let's recalculate required parking and adjust the seats accordingly?
Well, the other thing is, I mean, Nick did that on the fly. That's not really... It's
yeah, and remember, I can tell you the social implications of counting, but I cannot count.
I can lease less square footage in the mezzanine if that helps with the calculations. I mean, I don't have a tenant for that. I'm investing, a lot of money to make that space become productive. I don't have to spend the money to make it become productive if parking becomes a problem. So I'll withdraw whatever I need to withdraw from the mezzanine space. If that's the way, I hate to see that, because I think it's a good reuse of existing space that's non-productive right now. I think there might be businesses or some jobs that might go there, but if we're hung up on if the board can't get, and I understand the dilemma you guys are facing, we can always cut back the size of the business.
That would be with 300 square feet.
Yeah, that's a couple of offices though. Okay. That's a couple of offices worth of space. That's not an insignificant amount of office rental space.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Well, how do we go forward?
You know what? Actually, if we're trying to solve a problem, there's another thought. I'm not sure in the calculations, the first floor space for Golfsmith, the way it is, probably the footprint of the Golfsmith, we're actually taking back about 300 or so square feet to create the elevator lobby and the stairs to go up to the second floor to the mezzanine. If that space may be being double counted. That might be a solution to the problem too, just
I think maybe we can get a revised plan, a revised parking table.
Yeah.
And have you demonstrate compliance with zoning. And including the Starbucks outdoor seating.
Yeah.
For counting outdoor seating.
Does Starbucks count as a restaurant? I mean, is that a restaurant use or is that a retail use?
Restaurant.
It is?
Mm-hmm. Could I ask, if you're setting a boundary, is it possible to consider
less than one-for-one on the outdoor seating, knowing two things. It'll only be used 4 or 5, maybe 6 months a year, and it'll only be used in good weather during those 4 or 5. We're talking about maybe a third of the time. Is there a way of saying, you know, it doesn't count as a full, each seat doesn't count as a full seat, it counts as a third of a seat? I mean, I think that's not a bad policy, just as a...
Yeah, I think the challenge is coming up with what the right number is kind of on the fly. I think it's a great idea, and one you might want to consider in the future, but I don't know if it's, I don't necessarily feel safe doing that at this point without doing the right kind of due diligence.
How many seats did you say were on Oyez?
13.
This patio plan only shows like
12.
In Burlington, Mass., not to bring up out of the town, they have a policy where patio seating is counted at half the total patio seat count. You park for half of those. Just as an example.
That's helpful, thank you.
Which is, might be a good idea, but that's not really, I mean, I feel like we'd be creating zoning on the fly.
Right, right.
I mean, it's part of the PDP, so you could do it, but it's sort of not.
Well, I mean, the fixing the, or re-examining parking is on our agenda for zoning modifications, but not this year.
You know, Andy LeGregor from Wilds Companies. I came about a year or 3 months ago for Staples when we were taking back space and we were going to add a 4,000 square foot restaurant, and we still had the Macaroni Grill operating during that time. They'd have the right to put a restaurant there. So we were going for more seats, and I remember the same board, I believe, said, you know, we go there all the time and we've never seen a real parking problem. It's always been, it's been full at times, it's been, it fills up, but overall, it really works well. And I commended the board at the time for saying that, because, you know, we're trying to do the right thing and not have dark spaces, because dark spaces just really hurt the existing tenants. You know, it's not good for anybody.
I think our point there was that you still had empty spaces, and so we weren't going to push you on having all of the spaces you required today, when you still had, we were sort of kicking the can down to the next tenant. We knew, we didn't want to force you to comply with a number when we knew you had empty spaces anyways, even within your restaurant. We just wanted to get you in. And again, it's only one space, and maybe the lobby issue is what makes the number work.
So how do we want to proceed here? Is this something we ask them to come back?
It's three seats, by the way, right? It's one for three, as far as parking goes.
Right.
So it's one seat away from one patio, one seat away from one patio, one seat away from another patio. So you don't have to take a whole table away from Anthony's. Just put a couple of twos in or something. And then the numbers work, and then you can figure out the other stuff.
Can we do that?
I think that if personally, I think if we condition that that they come back and show a plan,
a reconciliation
that makes the numbers work, the square footage and the number of seats work that Jesse and Gene reviewed.
Right.
I'm good with that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Obviously,
staff,
the answer is not going to be to build more parking, right? I mean, that's not going to be the answer. The answer is to make sure that it works within the construct of what the zoning.
Yeah, I mean, the building inspector is the zoning enforcement officer, so we have to come up with a reconciliation that where the numbers match, where the numbers satisfy the existing requirements.
But he seemed to be, he led us kind of down this road, thinking that we were okay, not telling him. So I think we're only going to make it better.
Perfect.
So you want them to provide a plan to us, or back to you all?
No, to you.
Okay.
You guys can resolve that, whether it be this double counting of square footage potentially, removing a couple
just
of seats.
Table. Just revise that table to make it work.
Yeah.
Reducing the size of the mezzanine.
Yeah.
Yeah. just find a way that works.
Yes.
If you are adjusting the mezzanine, you'd probably want to see that on a plan showing that, you know what I mean, that that makes
yes.
sense.
Yep.
That if it is being double counted, then that correction
yep.
is made. So we'll do that before the issuance of a building permit.
So do we want to move into the decision, or do we have more questions that we want to ask?
You good?
For anybody anybody's from the public.
Wait, Karen, are we okay to move into the decision itself?
Sure, are we doing signage separate?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, yeah. Are there members of the public that want to make any comments or questions? No? Anybody else?
I was hoping that you could act on the signage as part of the package, that you could act on the signage.
I did not draft it that way. I was unsure if that's how it would be.
Do we have two separate in here, or just one?
Just two separate. We have Chipotle and Anthony's. Anthony's is behind that fan documents. It's all included.
But I don't think we have the actual...
I did not draft a decision. I mean, that doesn't mean that you can't add in a condition or a finding.
The freestanding sign was included in the package, though.
Right.
Okay. It's just not included in the decision that's been drafted.
Oh, right.
Yeah. The signage, I wasn't sure if that was...
Freestanding sign. Right.
But that doesn't mean like...
It was miscommunication.
I
was more or less concerned with the side sign and saying that the tenant, Anthony's, would come back to their own side sign, the side of the building signage, and we were going to take care of the wayfinding in the front.
I mean,
okay.
So Jesse was doing too much. We can come back on the signage.
I mean, it's up to the board.
I think
fine.
We should do it.
Is that what you're saying, or
I think we should. We could approve this. We could review the signage. There's enough detail here.
Yeah.
I agree. I don't think they have to come back.
Oh.
Yeah.
Unless you want
to. Yeah.
Try me.
We love you.
But
no, I think it's probably better procedurally if we have two separate decisions. But we can take care of it all tonight.
Yeah, I think that would be fine.
Okay. So we're going to do two separate decisions.
Right.
Okay. So let's, do we want to wait on signage and go through the
other
one?
Well, I think what you
well.
Probably could do is actually add in to the modification saying that.
That's fine. Yeah. Do you have any problems with that? Only because you suggested two decisions.
Well, I mean, in the draft decision, it says no signage is approved with this decision.
Okay,
so we just change
so.
That.
Yeah.
Get rid of that.
We have. I mean, if we want to change that, that's fine. But it's
okay. Let's do that. One decision, including signage. Does not include the side signage for Anthony's. They're going to come back for that.
Yep.
It's not including any landscaping, correct? Do they have to submit that to you, a landscape plan?
Yeah, I think I have that in here, right?
Okay.
And the lighting, too.
Yes.
The only thing I'd ask you to change, Jesse, besides the signage, was the building permit to certificate of occupancy.
Yeah.
Number five on the lighting, can that come back to staff too, as opposed to back to you?
Where's that?
It's solid on that.
Prior to the building permit, condition five.
Yeah. So I can go back to staff, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. What did you just say?
So I... So what I did was I added the parking condition.
Okay.
And then we need to move this one to issuance of an occupancy permit.
Six, I think. Is that it?
It was five. I think she changed some.
Right.
Yeah, so the applicant shall provide details on all proposed lighting, including proposed wall packs on the main building facade, but it's not that.
To that permanent structure that's being demoed next OEAs or attached to OEAs?
So I just left it, the applicant shall remove or properly permit the accessory structures located at the rear of the property.
Yeah, that covers it.
Finding number one has a typo in third sentence up, 50 interior seats.
Interior seats?
Lower. Lower, 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 lower. Right there.
Aside from the details of the wall signage, which I think is where you're going to go first, I don't think the freestanding sign meets zoning, which is okay because it meets the site plan review of the original site plan, but we don't have that. here with us today. So I only bring that up because I don't know what the requirements were for the signage, size of signage, and what the what the conditions were on the freestanding signs in the original agreement.
Yeah, I mean,
and
yeah.
That was not that's not anything we have in front of us. I know. I think I know. We probably know what was agreed to for the wall signage because it has all been pretty consistent. We can't go and look in this and say, oh well, it should be this because that sign doesn't meet.
There is a master signage plan of sorts, isn't there? A conglomerate for the.
There was an original, they didn't call it like design review back when this was originally permitted, and this sign did receive sign review by CPDC.
For four signs?
Correct.
For four panels?
Correct.
But is it okay to add two?
I haven't looked at that decision in a while.
That's all I'm getting to is. We need, before we approve that freestanding sign, we need to go back and look
yeah.
and see if it complies with that that master signage program. Sorry.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
Can you approve it subject to that being the case, and if not, then we have to come back?
Well, ultimately, that decision is going to say this is approved for four signs, and I think ultimately it's going to have to come back before the board for an amendment.
It might say four signs, or it might say it might have a square footage, right?
I think it showed like specifically like these signs.
There's never any accommodation for subdividing all those spaces. They thought Staples was going to be there forever.
So it'll be our call on an interpretation of intent.
Okay, well, if it says four signs with a maximum square footage of, then we know that if it sort of fits within that envelope, we're okay, or close to it.
Yeah.
I think we have to understand that the building's going to change somewhat.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Is the proposal there to slide the other four signs up?
Yes. No, two. Essentially, slide the top two up.
Yeah, all four.
Well, all four, yeah. We're adding two to the bottom slide. What drove the original sign was the number of tenants. I mean, it was
right.
That's what we had. And no, we didn't have enough foresight to realize we might need more in the future. So we probably should have, but there's a lot of things to think about when you're doing a project like this, and apparently this was really this. But whether or not there's a code issue of compliance, I don't recall.
If you remember the discussion Chili's that we had a few weeks ago, and there's a little bit more discretion with the PUD when it comes to signs. So
I'd be okay with this if it's close to what they agreed to, what the original agreement was.
And
so the agreement said one sign, 2 square feet, and this is way over.
I would be too. The problem to doing that tonight is we don't.
No, I'd like to know what it is.
Yeah.
I'd like to know what that was before we approved it.
Okay.
I mean, I'd like to know where the top of that, what's the height of that? Total height of that, for example, with the new arrangement?
What are the sizes?
Why can't the new tenants go on top?
Two feet.
Cabinet
size. All right, I think it's probably best that we wait on signage then to get an understanding of what was approved. Make sure that we can work within those parameters or change them if we need to.
The building signage, I think we could go ahead and approve if we wished.
I think the building signage we can look at.
That's a good point. You're right. Yeah.
Okay.
And then we'll leave just only the freestanding sign as a,
an open item.
Open item, yeah. Building signage looks good.
So that's considered two sides for Tacoma?
What do you mean?
Well, it's two separate panels, right?
Yeah, but does that really two sides?
I wouldn't think so. I think you would probably add up the entire, this 13 feet, so the dimension of the sign would be 13 by
okay.
26 and three quarters.
Right. 27 square feet. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So solid back, solid red panel with illuminated letters. So no halo lighting behind it or anything?
Correct. So they stick off of the aluminum channel letters? Or, are they channel letters? Just cut through the aluminum. White acrylic letters for the recessed graphics for the logo.
Yeah, so it's a base white cabinet and they are channel letters, so I apologize.
Close to the top. Oh,
this looks really big, right?
Yeah, that was drafted prior before I got the signage. So.
This is not hard to see, but this is it in scale.
Okay.
Oh,
that's very small.
Yeah, I was drafted on our end just to give an idea of what it was going to look like. Go ahead and sign the material.
Any questions or comments on Anthony's?
Can't find it.
It's behind. Sorry.
So these are channel letters just mounted directly to the building with no back. Anthony's.
Flush mounted. Yes.
Yeah. Flush mount the building.
So what's lit up on this? The Anthony's coal-fired pizza, and is the pizza well done part lit up as well?
Yeah, the letters in that sign.
Did you mention that you thought there might be a variance for Mac for the grill?
Yes, there is a variance.
There is for both signs?
Correct.
Is that what it is?
Yes, they have a variance. They actually have it for the second wall sign, and then they like have that little to-go
sign.
Right.
So they have a total of three signs, actually four on the site, if you count the freestanding Mac grill.
Yeah.
So they had a variance for the additional wall signs.
So why couldn't we approve two signs for this, two wall signs?
You could if you wanted to have it contingent upon them seeking an additional variance.
The why would they need an additional variance?
Yeah, I don't understand.
The variant, the, well, I did speak with the building inspector, and he said that it is issued specifically for Macaroni Grill.
A variance issued for...
A variance is an issue.
Have a lawyer to chime in on that one.
The variance runs with the land. Let me just take a quick look.
Yeah, so I guess it would depend if the request was for something different than what was originally proposed. So Anthony's is proposing the two wall signs, or, you know, are they also taking up a freestanding sign as well? That where Macro was?
If they're going to go on that sign, but the sign is there already.
Yeah.
And the sign on the side is actually slightly less than the sign that Macro had.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I guess my understanding was always that if you're issued a variance, you can recreate that anytime you want.
Right.
That was the issue with Jiffy Lube, right, being granted their variance. Yeah. Anybody can go in there now and put two signs in. So as long as they're putting in less than four signs, three wall and one panel.
I guess if the variance was issued on certain criteria, the basis of certain signage requirements or the design.
I'm not a lawyer, but I never understood it to work that way. That's why I'm always cautious when we're trying to have signs.
Basically, the variance is recorded with the property.
Right.
So it's,
if I made the decision, while they reference the sign, is a variance to allow a second sign, and therefore it runs with the land and runs with the building. There's a size limitation, but that's all. So the right should still be there, just to pay to change the...
A second sign, a second wall sign?
Yes.
Because the third sign would be the panel sign.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Did they also issue the variance for this little
for
to-go,
a to-go sign
to-go
above
one
it?
As
right,
well?
That was the third one down.
Yeah.
But you're not going to have that.
No. So actually it's more consistent with zoning. If they get a variance for two signs, they're just looking for a variance of relief from one.
Okay.
And it's the same size and same design as the front of the
sign?
It's slightly
smaller,
actually. Very close, but smaller.
It couldn't be larger, but if it's
right.
smaller.
Right. But same design, same lighting, all that.
You, no,
yep.
No, the question is this sign right here going to be the same on the front and the side?
Yeah, they, it should
it's
be
14 by 63?
Yes, they're both the exact same
it's
sign.
The exact same sign. Right, that's,
yeah,
that
that's my question. Thank you. Yeah, let's...
Are you guys okay with that?
I'm fine with
yeah.
that.
Yeah. One question on the sign. I see the fire
oh.
in the A, what looks like
yeah.
flames.
Animated.
With the potential that someone might think that they can animate that.
So they can't be moving.
It cannot be moving.
Right.
Yeah.
We'll confirm that with the tenant.
It doesn't say that in here, but I can see someone.
We'll make sure
saying,
that.
Well, you're going to stamp. Are we stamping this like we stamp signage?
Because
you could just put a note on that, so it's non-animated.
Yeah. What, Jesse? What do you need me to stamp?
Gosh. Probably.
This. Or this.
I would say both.
One of each, yeah.
Okay.
And then the sandwich.
And then for Chipotle. That's more the scale?
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah.
All right, we got anything else? Jesse, do you have anything you need to finish this off?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have a motion.
Before we do
yep.
that, what we could do is we could investigate what the conditions are for the panel signs. And if we find out what that is, couldn't we just approve it without having them come back based on what they've submitted for those panels, if it complies? If it doesn't, obviously they have to redo it. But.
Yeah.
Well, we can probably approve administrative review of the freestanding sign.
Yeah.
If we find that it's compliant.
Right.
What
yeah.
they've submitted
yes.
complies.
Yeah.
Okay.
You good with that, Jesse?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's do that.
Okay.
As a separate.
As
motion.
Separate, so, yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Let's see. I have to do the wordsmithing on the fly here.
Good at that, though. Never cease to amaze.
Move that the CPDC approve the proposed modification for the property at what's our address here? Walker's Brook Crossing.
2.
The application of 2 Walker's Brook Crossing LLC for the development of Walker's Brook Crossing, Reading, Mass, as amended.
Second.
How do we do the signage? Or did we?
Oh, the
well, the signage should be included in this.
Yeah, I just drafted it as a condition.
Okay, so we've got the signage is therefore included. Move that the CPDC authorize administrative review of the proposed modifications to the freestanding sign for additional tenants.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No, I just don't care what you're doing. She has questions. She's just letting you know.
Thank you.
All right, next up on our agenda, certificate of appropriateness for signage at 34 Gould Street, Peg Residi Photography.
Uh-huh.
All right.
Okay.
All right, Jesse, you got any intro comments or we're going to hand it off?
It's pretty straightforward, so
yes.
I will just give it to Peg. But basically, I'm at 34 Gould Street, and I would like to have a sign on the side of the building, and it's been approved by the landlord. And it's just a simple logo on white backgrounds with blue letters. I really wanted to differentiate from PureFit, so I would interfere with their signage. We decided to put it up a little bit higher just to make it known that I'm on the second floor of the building. So that's why it's just a little bit higher.
Mm-hmm.
So it will be viewed while if you were, say, walking or driving up Haven Street from the train station.
Bold enough for you?
That's what?
Is it bold enough? I mean, you think it'll read? It's really subtle. I mean, it's just script.
And it's script. I think
originally it was larger and the sign itself, and Peg's logo is very fine. But the landlord expressed a problem with the other signs that were there. It wasn't huge, but it was just somewhat bigger. And so we basically just shrunk the size of it. She just really wanted basically a placard to let people know that that's where she is when they pull up there, because there's just no way to tell what's in that building.
Sure.
PureFit sort of looks like it's they're the whole building.
Yeah.
Right.
And so you can't really tell by any of the drawings because it's on the corner, but that sign should probably be, will be at the same height as the PureFit wall sign on the other wall. So it doesn't look like you got a blade sign here and a sign here and another sign there. It will sort of wrap around.
Right.
Oh, I see. You can see from that. That wall sign is higher than the blade.
Right. Yeah, so hers will be like right here.
Yeah. No, and I agree with Nick in the if you went with a heavier stroke on the sign, it would be more eye-catching.
Okay. You can actually put a tiny outline on what you have now. It wouldn't change your script.
Okay.
It would just make it slightly heavier, so it would be a little...
Just from a distance, I think. I just think it might be hard to see from a distance.
Okay.
Certainly people nowadays tend to know where they're going, but...
Course, I want people to see, but it's also it's the script, but it's also the logo. So it just is like the whole thing. I don't have a logo per se, so that's the whole thing.
It won't change the script. It will just be slightly bolded.
Yes.
Sure.
Okay. Does that sound good?
Sure. And it's Rossidi with an R, correct?
An R. Yes.
So the decision needs to be. There's a typo on the name.
Rossidi.
Peg Fassidi.
Peg.
It's the first Peg Rossidi. There you go.
Oh, the
yeah, that's my thing. That's all I'm good for. Yeah, within the parameters of what was submitted, the font.
Yeah.
The font may be bolder. Something like that.
Let me find the colored copy.
That way you won't get any grief from the building inspector if he sees something different than that.
Do we have a color copy in our packets? It's just what was provided to us.
I'll show the color is a blue. I'm sorry. I think that was my bad.
Oh, no, that's all right.
I was having problems. If you'd like to, with my printer.
No problem.
If you do have a color one that he can use, that might be.
Yes,
if you stamp that one and give that to the building inspector, that.
Actually, that's.
Oh,
that was
okay.
Perfect. Yeah, I don't need these. This is great.
Okay.
And so the note would be.
Okay. Font maybe slightly.
All right. Any other questions?
No.
Nope.
All right.
Move that the CPDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for the proposed sign of Peg Rossidi Photography. 34 Gold Street.
Second. All those in favor? All right. I'm sorry, I wish we could have gotten you in and out a lot sooner than that. Thanks for your patience. So we're going to take a 5-minute break. We'll be right back with you. appropriateness for master signage plan at 180 Haven Street, Rain Co-op in Kellen, or Keller William. So, Jesse, you want to kick us off?
Sure. So the application is for a master signage plan for 180 Haven Street. This is where the Rain Co-op Bank is. They are looking at adding some tenant space on the second floor of their building, so they needed to rethink what they had for signage. Included in your package was not only the master signage plan, but they also showed you what the proposed tenant signage would be. But they did want to get a master signage plan on file should their tenant upstairs decide to leave. They figured might as well submit all four at once. So that's what is before you tonight.
Great. Good evening. I'm Ed Girello from United Sign Company. With me tonight is Jason Parasala from Keller Williams. And earlier today, Julie Thurlow from Reading Cooperative asked me to give her apologies, but she was at the last minute unable to attend the meeting tonight. So she asked me to make the presentation here for her. What we're looking to do is one thing, Jason has leased the entire second floor of the Reading Cooperative Bank building, as the code is read now by the building inspector, he's not allowed to sign as a second floor tenant. So therefore, we're asked to submit the master signage plan. What we're looking to do in this plan is for the first floor tenant, the bank, to be allowed two signs, one on the first floor in the area that's marked out in the dotted yellow lines, and then one in the rear of the building facing the parking lot. The second floor tenant, Keller Williams, would be allowed one single sign up above the second floor windows. The type of sign that's been chosen is our halo lit channel letters. So there'll be a background panel that the letters will be mounted on. The faces will not light up at all. They'll just get halo light into the back of the building. And that would be for all three signs. That would be for the two signs in the front of the building and the one sign in the rear of the building. We've got the locations and the type of signs marked out. As for size, we're simply stating that we'd like it to be whatever size would be allowed based on the current ordinance. Do you want to talk about this, or do you want me to present the signs of the proposal?
Keep going.
All right. So the signs that we're looking at on the front of the building for Reading Cooperative Bank would be a single sign, 30 inches by 29 feet, with red and black letters, and their multicolored logo is red, gray, and black dots that would be on the panel. None of that would light up. Again, just the halo lighting around the letters would be lit up at night. On the second floor, the proposed sign for Keller Williams is 30 inches by 17 feet. And again, those would be all red letters on a white background, halo lit. And then the one sign in the rear building for the bank would be one that goes over the entrance, 14 inches tall by 13 feet wide. Again, that this would be a brushed aluminum background with red and black letters and a multicolored halo lit letters. Okay.
I got a couple of questions.
Yeah, please.
Yes. So when you look at that picture right there that shows the yellow limits
yes.
of it, thing I don't like is that the top sign is covering up the building's architectural elements. So there's a Soldier Corps header across the windows, and then there's a couple of keystones, but the sign is so high that it's filling up part of the header course. Whereas the Reading Cooperative sign fits nicely within its band. I'm just wondering why that can't be, say, 2 foot, I think it's 2'2" is the clear from the cornice to the top of the header course.
There's only about 10 feet, I believe, between the windows to stay off those courses. We did bring hold the size down so it would stay off the corner stuff, the keystones.
Yeah, the yellow top doesn't depict it correctly. It's within the keystones.
Yeah, no, right. but it's still covering up part of the Soldier Course.
It's just that we're limited with space up here.
Yeah, but there's no competition for that sign. It's not like it won't be seen if it's 8 inches shorter, 8 inches narrower. I mean, if I count the bricks, that's what I was getting. It just seems like it's thrown on top of there. I also don't understand why they're both not, say, right justified, since there's nothing symmetrical about centering it on that space. But that's just...
So how would you try to do that? Because we looked at that before, and we just thought that trying to stay off those keystones there and keeping the sign center justified kind of gave it a little bit more balance. Yeah, we did have a discussion
at the bottom,
about that.
The windows in the bottom aren't symmetrical. The Reading Cooperative sign just takes up the whole band, and you get three different windows. I don't mind that so much as the fact that it's sort of covering up the window architecture. And, you know, if we were doing a master signage plan from when the building was built, we certainly wouldn't be covering that up. I don't see why you need to cover it. And again, I don't think you're going to lose exposure because really there's nothing in that whole section of the street. You know, there's the gap, and then there's the EMF Charles building. It's subway sign, it's lower anyway, so there's like no competition for this sign. So if it was a little bit smaller to fit up in there, I think it'd still be more than visible enough. Anyways, that'd just be my preference, for to see it not look like it was just applied, you know, just stuck on there. It's really, it's almost down to the head of the window.
Is there any appetite to make it smaller to fit within?
And I don't know what
it
your
would
proportions
be
are.
Of the windows. What's that?
I don't know what the proportions are. It's 30 inches to 200 inches. So if that went down to 20, I don't know what it is. It might be 26 inches. I'd have to get you'd have to get a much more detailed picture or get up there and measure it somehow.
I've got 35 inches up there, and if you're saying that head of brick would be 8 inches.
It's above the header to the course below the cornice is it's 2 feet plus a brick, so it's. It's like 2'2" high. All right, every 3 bricks is 8 inches.
So you're saying make it narrower?
Well, I think he wants to keep his proportion because that's your logo, right?
Yeah.
So if this got narrower, this would get shorter.
Right.
Okay. I don't know what the ratio is because I'm not figuring it out. But it should be above. If I put it up a little bit, I just don't think it should be covering this.
Yeah, I mean, you basically, if you shrink the backing panel, you wouldn't necessarily have to make the letters smaller.
A little bit, but you're right.
Yeah.
You could maybe
have a little
that.
Negative space on there.
Oh, I understand, but I mean, it wouldn't be a dramatic. Change in the lettering size.
What are we roughly say 26 inches.
It's probably 26 inches max. We could say 26 inches max to fit above the header, of course, and below the corners. And then you can figure out your proportions. And if you want to try and cheat the background a little bit so the letters stay larger, you could do that.
I'm just curious, too, how is that going to look in proportion to the, and again, I'm not in any way, shape, or form looking to do anything to the Reading Co-op sign. So I'm just curious how the top sign is going to look in proportion to the bottom side stays the same.
Well, the letters down below, the letters down below already look smaller, so it looks off balance. Because typically, you want things to get smaller as they go up.
The same, so you'd be able to keep the length the same.
We can keep the length the same, and maybe do a little bit of letter spacing. They won't pick up. So we could, you know, we could certainly do that.
Are you really putting the? Is that a trademark? The bottom of the S.
That's just part of the logo. I resent putting trademarks on signs for some reason. I don't think we need to do that.
But are you putting it or not putting it?
No, we're not putting it.
Okay. And you said that the Reading Cooperative logo was not lit, but on the dark.
The logo is lit, but it doesn't. Each individual dot doesn't light.
Okay.
Okay.
It's a halo lit block.
It's halo lit.
Right.
The block itself will light, but you won't get anything behind those individual dots. It could be done, but.
See, it already looks off balance because the top letters are much bigger than the bottom letters, and it should be the other way around. Because your eye perceives it going away from you, and it's going to seem like it's falling towards you.
So the length would be the same, but we just we narrow down the height.
I think you should consider that, though. I mean, when you shrink it down, you should look and see how much white space you end up with, or silver space, if that's what it is. Aluminum.
That'll be the white background up there. So
it's white.
Yeah.
No, it is painted white. Oh, I wouldn't keep it. I would shrink it back a little bit too. Otherwise, it's just going to look like it's again thrown on.
We could probably do some letter spacing in between to the space.
That proportion is good. I just think it needs to all get a little smaller.
Right.
And remember, it's still going to be. It's almost 20 feet long. It's still a big sign. Not 20, sorry, 16 feet or 17 feet.
Yeah, we can bring it down a small amount. It won't be a major. We could do that.
Good math. You do the math.
No, I'm not. Stretch it to do that.
You're able to keep the proportion right?
We can keep everything right.
Let me see. 4, 26.
So it almost ends up above the keystones.
Well, it's still going to be within it. Those soldier bricks will come right to the top. We'll be above those.
Yeah.
It'll be about 15 feet long. Whereas now it's 17 feet long. That's really not that dramatic a change. But it just won't. It'll look like it has some thought put into where it's placed.
And I'm assuming that with the master signage plan, you'd want the yellow line to be above that also?
Yeah, I think the master signage should show the placement of it.
Yeah. I can submit the drawing for that.
Yep, that'd be good.
Okay. What other comments? Like you said, you had a couple.
The rest was justification, but I'm not married to that either. I'm okay with it the way it is. I was thinking it would look better if they were both to the right, but.
Well, actually, it's fine. I think the reason why we originally did to do that because we're going to block the keystone. So now the keystone's not needed.
But the keystones stick up above that a little bit, so we still need to stay in the middle.
We still need to stay in the middle.
Otherwise, we're going to cross over the keystone and make it shorter.
That's why we put it in the middle.
And there is one other part to this. Part of the conditions for were put on this was in the front of the building at the entrance, right in the stone, there is a carved sign that says Reading Cooperative Bank. And Julie was looking to see if there's any avenue that she can take to keep that. It's a very subtle thing. I mean, there's no color difference, you know, just a little shadowing there, too. So whether if it would be possible for this board to allow it, or if she had to go, you know, to look for a variance, she'd like to explore that before we say that we're going to obliterate that one way or another, you know, stop it over, or cover it over in some is a problem because the new proposed sign would cover that. But
talking about this.
That's correct.
And what is the concern?
It's considered a sign, so that would be a third sign. Okay, but it's quite different. There's no contrast in letters. You know, it's carved in. Into the stone that's above there too. So, you know, she was looking to see if there's any avenue that we could explore that would allow us to hold on to that too.
I don't think we don't have the ability to.
Well, the
prove that.
One possibility would be to have in the master signage plan for the building. Have the area for first floor tenant sign one, and then alternate area for the first floor tenant, which would be over the door. So basically, the first floor tenant could choose one or the other in terms of the master signage plan. And because they're proposing their new logo, if you will, for the rear, the parking lot side, and they could do basically the same thing on the front instead of the one on the wall.
We went through the decision process, and she really does want to do the wall sign there. But I mean, you can see even in the picture, if someone didn't tell you that was there, they wouldn't know it. You know, it was a very subtle look that doesn't really grab anyone's attention there too. Rather than take it out, you know, she's just looking for a way. Now, perhaps this board can't do it, but if we could approve the program, the master signage plan, without requiring that to be taken out until we see if we could go to the ZBA, or some process like that.
Would that be the ZBA?
As it stands, it's a sign, and they have too many signs.
Right.
They can do the front, right? Or what, can you have two signs on?
They can have a total of two signs. Reading Cooperative Bank can have two signs. So at this point, it's up to them what they want to have, but once they reach that three, they're going to be non-compliant.
They could put the sign in the front. They just couldn't put the sign in the back until they resolve with ZBA. About this piece, right?
Well, no, because there's already a carved sign in that section back there too.
That's right. Those are all signs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are a lot of blades.
You know, at one time, that might have been effective, but there's quite a bit of banking now on that street, and there's a lot of competition, and that's the reason for the new branding and the new signage there too. But it just seems to, seems to be a shame that you have to take that out. Yes, it is a sign. There are letters there too, but it's extremely subtle. It's it's right over the entrance. For example, if that was an awning, you could probably do that on there. It's not an awning,
no.
Right?
If it's a sign, if a graphic's on an awning, it's considered an awning sign.
Right. But they would be allowed an awning sign.
No.
Yes. No.
Not in addition.
It would be considered an additional sign.
Okay.
You're a lot of blade sign.
We give, we could look at that. We could talk. We could talk to the ZBA and give up the right to the blade sign in order to keep that.
Well, ultimately, you're allowed two signs, whether it's a combination of two wall signs, a wall sign, and
right.
A blade sign.
But the ZBA could grant the third.
Correct.
So, we understand that we're not allowed three as it stands.
That's. Your avenue, if you want to pursue that, we wouldn't be able to approve that.
Right.
So I can tell you now that that's what you'd like to do.
Okay.
So rather than take that out right now, we'd like to pass the master plan. If the ZPA doesn't allow it, we can take it out. If you want us to temporarily cover it, I can come up with a plan for that too. So we went to the ZPA.
So that, you won't be able to install the signage as you're proposing until you address it, something with the ZBA.
Okay.
So the building inspector will not issue you a permit that exceeds what you're allowed?
Well, they can't do the bank signage. They can, they can approve the master signage plan the way David said with multiple locations.
Yes.
They can put the Keller Williams sign up.
Correct.
Right.
But they can't do the bank signage.
We can't do the bank sign until either that before the ZBA is allowed or denied.
You can do the back.
Right, you can do the parking lot sign.
Yes, you could.
Well, no, not really, because you have the same carved piece in the parking lot.
No, well.
Well, if you're covering it up, though.
Oh, we're covering it up.
If you do the new sign in the back, he would.
Okay.
But no sign on front.
No sign on the front till that's resolved.
Correct.
Right.
Understood.
So you can actually do most of it.
Yeah.
Take care of Mr. Williams, or whatever it is, Keller Williams.
Keller Williams would be allowed to go.
Yeah, as long as you don't have more than two signs at one time for Reading Co-op, you're allowed that, as long as it's in the parameters of the CPDC decision.
Yeah, and if you want to move it, you know, every 6 months, I mean, that's, would be odd, but you could do that.
I'll make a different color one every 6 months, if that's what they want, but.
Tony, you had a question or comment?
Tony DeRosa, 130 John Street. I don't think the Williams Keller sign is even allowed. Section 8.2.3, note A. States no portion of such sign shall extend higher than the bottom of the sills of the windows of the second floor of a building, or higher than the lowest portion of the eaves, or in the case of gabled wall, no higher than a line equal in height to the lowest portion of the lower eave of any adjoining building, wall, whichever of the above is lowest.
Hmm. That's awkward.
It's because the second floor usually puts their sign right where the Reading Cooperative sign goes. One Haven, Two Haven.
So that was sort of brought up, and we do have signs where, you know, they have been issued. I mean, there's the sign at Embellish.
Yep.
That was issued much higher than, I think, than.
It's below the eave. What does the eave language say? The first part of it?
Or higher than the lowest portion of the eaves, or in the case of a gabled wall, no higher than the line equal in height to the lowest portion of the lower eave of any adjoining building wall.
Well, that's probably how Embellish is in there. Embellish has a slight overhang.
Yeah, so theirs is right there.
They have two signs up there.
Yeah, they have one on Main Street facade too, I think. To master signage plan, I know the building inspector sort of relies on the CPDC to make sort of some calls. There's language, and you know, I don't know.
Remember when that was written? That was written, okay, while second floor signs weren't allowed. So they're saying, so that law is essentially saying a first floor sign can't be above the sill of the second floor window, because that's the only sign that's allowed. What the purpose of the master signage plan is to allow a second floor tenant a sign, and that's where they're located, on the second floor.
And Havens, on the one Haven Street there, they're all below the windows.
Which one's one Haven?
Corner of Lincoln and Haven. I mean, not Lincoln.
High Street.
High Street, yeah. That one. They're just not showing up now, but it's an old picture. So both of those buildings, left and right, have signs right there. See them? Right in the midspan. That's where they go.
So when it, in our bylaw, we do the language. So the CPDC manages where the appropriateness, showing the allocation within the maximum sign areas allowed in the table hereof among wall signs for businesses within the building. This master signage plan shall show size, placement, material, framing, graphic design, and standards for each such sign and the assemblage thereof. Proposed within the set allowable maximum sign area together with the proposed lighting and other attachment.
What section is that?
It's. Do you have the most recent?
I think so.
Page 64. 8 point, so the section.
Yeah.
8.2.6.2L1. It's in the middle of the paragraph.
But it also says in L, that's what I was just looking at. The master signage plan shall not show more than one wall sign per business within the building.
Mm-hmm.
You see that in the middle
mm-hmm.
of the paragraph? However, at the owner's election, not every business within the building need to be provided with a wall sign.
Don't we allow more than one wall sign when they front? More than one public way or a parking lot, or is that just design guys? Smart, is it the smart road stuff?
Contradicts what we allow in business B or multi-tenanted buildings.
Yeah. Yes. There's a conflict in our zone. How can that be?
Approve one with the sign being sort of at the top like this.
I wasn't here, but the embellish was under
yeah,
a master
one, right?
Signage plan.
That's the next point. There's kind of an overhang, so maybe that sets.
You know, I looked at the file. There really wasn't much said about it. I think there really wasn't. I think much discussion on it. I think there really isn't any other place to put that sign.
Yeah, there's nowhere else to put it.
Because it's all windows.
Okay. So, in strict interpretation of the current zoning, the Keeley Williams sign needs to be where the Reading Cooperative Bank sign is. In the sign band. And the Reading Cooperative Bank sign needs to be over the door.
But didn't you read that part of the decision of the master signage plan with this board is placement of the sign?
Master signage plan shall show the size, placement, material, framing, graphic, and design standards for each such sign. I mean, it's sort of vague.
Yeah, but it references back to the 8.23 table, unfortunately.
Maximum sign areas as allowed.
Mm-hmm. So this table reference is for the size, maximum sign area.
John, the allocation within the maximum sign area is allowed according to table 8.2.3.
Okay, so I guess, depending on who reads it, then the placement limitation is not, can be overridden by the master signage plan.
Why? The table references Note A, and Note A is what tells you where it can go.
Right.
Yeah, but the master signage plan references only maximum sign area as allowed in the table. It doesn't specify necessary the placement.
But you couldn't approve. You can't approve something that doesn't comply with the code.
It says in the about master signage plans is that it has to be in conformity with the requirements of the entire section.
Okay.
Section 8.0.
Is there a way to possibly put, I mean, obviously you'd get a much smaller signs, but utilizing this band for both of the signs?
That's something Julie would have to answer. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to make it.
And what's going on with the side? The side.
What's that?
Is there space on the side?
This?
Yeah. What about that section?
I'm not sure what that. I'm not sure what that vent is. But if we could go over that, you could certainly do that.
Put one side there, and then one side in front of the building.
I mean, I think you probably even get more visibility that way with people driving.
One way.
So one way street.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
I don't know what that is.
Seems to me awkward that people are going to get confused. Who's like? It seems to me if someone's on the second floor, you want the sign on the second floor, but
if you can't,
might be kind of confusing. One corner says Keller Williams, and they look before they start keep driving says Ready Co-op.
Well, it's only one door.
Yeah.
You gotta get into the building.
Oh, don't go in the door.
That would work.
Then we don't change. If that happens, then we don't have to change the size.
No.
The only thing I'm concerned with is there is a vent unit there, and I just got to find out that to make sure that we're not going to be interfering with anything with that too.
Right.
Okay.
Right. I mean, is Julie going to be?
No, she's not.
We haven't changed her sign, so you'll probably be okay with that. If you are comfortable with that, I would ask the board to pass that, and if there's an objection from the building owner,
then
we'll have to come back in 2 weeks and with a revised proposal.
Yeah.
Is it concluded that the second floor signage isn't allowed in this particular situation ever on the master plan?
Well, you're not going to get that here tonight.
It's not allowed above the windows.
Yeah. I see. Okay.
Yeah. And I think embellish was a special condition because the modern building is all glass and we had no place to put it.
So
yeah,
I mean,
there wasn't much in the file, but I would assume there's very limited hall space.
Well, it's interesting that there's that whole band on the first floor. It's a whole little tank. Bank of America is. So logically, you'd think that they would have had to put embellish on that same band with the Bank of America.
Yeah, the other places do have it in the band. Everything along the Main Street side or the Ash Street side, they all are in that band.
Because there is a whole band there.
So. Hey, Christopher's, Kumon, whatever else is in there. That actually looks like there's people upstairs too.
Is that signage up there?
Yeah, that's for that building. I don't know why we did that then.
It's like the driving school and something else.
Yeah, that was a, at least a special permit, if not a variance.
So do we want to move forward with approving the plan?
Why did we do that? Also, was it done, I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's
was it done before this version of the signed bylaw?
No, this signed bylaw hasn't been changed that much recently.
3 years ago?
But for the second floor parts? I don't think this part, I don't think this part of it changed.
Yeah.
I think we, what did we do? We added blade signs maybe or something, and A-frame signs and things like that. So that building, on corner, originally the guy came back and he was gonna stucco over the whole thing. Remember, it was gonna be this big red monstrosity. It's a guy who owned the Cal properties there. He was gonna change the look entirely. And then I think he sold it and the people who bought it wanted to maintain that sort of modernist look to it. And so we might have just made a concession that that was the best way to do signage on that building because it seemed to fit. So that could just be for its site plan review. I don't remember why we did it.
There was a modification. The original for 530 Main Street, there was an original master signage plan and then Embellish came back, so there was a modification to that master signage plan that did afford them signage where it is. I didn't see anything else in the files or the minutes related to the topic of height.
If the board would agree, we'd like to change our proposal for the second floor sign to be put on the corner of the building here, okay, at the size that we have presently proposed, 30 inches by 17
yeah.
feet, and if we go back to the building owner and they say that's not acceptable, we'll refile and come back in. I can provide Jesse with a revised plan and modify the master plan to make that location the second floor location.
Okay. Yeah, that'll work.
And then for the CARF sign in the front of the building there too, we'd like to go to the ZBA. If the
yeah.
ZBA says no, then that'll come down. But we understand we can't put up the red ink walk in back until a decision is made from the ZBA.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sounds good. Yeah.
Right.
Tony.
Mr. Chairman, Tony DeRosa, 130 John Street. Just out of curiosity, if the two signs over the doors that are carved in said Reading Co-op Building, would that make them building markers as opposed to signage for the bank?
I thought that too, but I think it'll cost them just as much to replace the or add the building piece of it.
The answer is probably.
Yeah.
That should teach you not to name your to name your building and not your business, I guess. See, if they were to permit that, that would set a really bad precedent because then everybody would do it, and then they would claim that, well, it's carved, but if I paint some shadows inside the sign, it is still subtle. You know, oh, it's just gold leaf, it's subtle. Oh, it's just, you know, it's a trobloy now, it's subtle. And then it's still more signage, more and more signage.
We didn't put up those flashing lights.
The neon wasn't flashing when we installed it.
Mm, right.
All right.
I think you get better. Visibility. Everybody has to turn down that way.
Yeah.
And you'll actually see it from Main Street. That whole corner as it opens.
Okay, so. Is there anything that
going on after? Jesse's on it.
Do you want to
have to change the size because they'll both be the same height.
Right,
so
we have the
work.
Same height. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Jesse, work around here.
You just can't stamp anything until they submit the revised drawings. Show words. This is for the master signage plan, correct?
Right.
Yes, so I guess if you approve the master signage plan, then the drawings would just be issued by Glenn, the actual sign permit, so.
Reverse. Number two,
mm-hmm.
I know number three, where it says, I'm looking up at the findings. Is that, what facade is that?
Oh, this
not
would be a
Street.
Different one, yeah.
It's the...
it's the municipal parking lot, which is...
Is there a name for that?
I just
wasn't there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the driveway facade. That's what that is right there. But yeah. That's the exit from the parking lot.
Yeah.
So the master submitted identifies it.
CPDC approve the master signage plan certificate of appropriateness for the property at 180 Haven Street as amended.
Second.
All those
in favor? All right.
Right.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Great evening.
Thanks.
I whittle a lot of things by planning with you. Zoning amendments, review of draft language, telecommunications bylaw, aquifer protection district. Let's start with aquifer. I think we could probably knock that out. I know that we sent, Jesse, you sent an updated version out that town council had finalized.
Yeah, so really. He was okay with the changes to the definition. He only made a minor change, which was
Actually, I'm not even seeing that change. In regards to the question about the purpose statement, he was a little hesitant about referencing anything specific on the administrative consent order. But before saying one way or another, he really wanted to read the consent order and see what was actually required. We did get our hands on a lot of the information, and as part of the consent order, we were to come up with a plan to show compliance with protection of our zone two wellhead areas. And so it may have been sort of our own admission of identifying protection of the aquifer protection district as sort of that measure to comply with the requirements for the administrative consent order. So he wanted to look into it a little further, but he certainly did not want to reference specifically the consent order.
Well, here's the thing, is if we aren't specifically required to do that, or if it's an interpretation by the town, former town administrator, that that's what we need, then maybe the discussion is different.
Right, so
if it doesn't spell out specifically this is what you need to do, then that has always been the discussion, that this, we need it because it says it in the ACO. If that's not the case, then
yeah. So
I don't know why
there were certainly quite a few documents that were forwarded over to him.
So that'd be good for him to
take a look at that. Yeah, there was the actual consent order, the NWR agreement, the FEIR, all the information from back then. I do want to say it was something that, as a condition of the ACO, we developed a plan that they approved, and our plan said that we were going to have this aquifer protection district. That's the way at least I'm looking at it, but he's going to look into it a little bit more. So until then, he would be a little bit hesitant to change that.
He'll have that research done in time for Monday?
Yeah, we should be able to at least have a better idea of what we can have.
So that's the only open item for aquifer?
Yeah. That was it.
Anybody have any other concerns or questions regarding it?
The back and forth on the underground storage tanks is starting to make me crazy.
Yeah.
It's a definition. Regulatory language doesn't belong in a definition. So the fact that, you know, there are some tanks which are not disallowed shouldn't be part of the definition. It's basically the underground storage tank is something that, you know, any portion of with, et cetera, you know, end of first sentence. The exclusion, if any, you know, the allowance for, you know, the oil tank in your basement, I mean, should be in the regulatory section. You know, why this is so hard to clarify, I'm not sure, but
I'm on the same page with you, David. Just so they don't feel like you're out there on the
line. You know, it's a case where we need positive language saying what is allowed. You know, and we've got the language here. The question is finding the right place to put it.
I can ask him open to taking a look at it.
Yeah, I mean, I guess let's not spend time tonight because we already spent a lot of time doing that.
Right.
There's some reasoning why he keeps going back to this, as you point out, the sort of the negative language versus the way that we want it with the positive language and the definition and then the prohibitive language in the prohibitions. So if there's some reason, if there's something we're missing,
please let us know.
Please let us know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So can you follow up with him on that?
Sure.
Will he be here on Monday?
We're going to see, I believe, at least he or one of his associates will be able to. I think he indicated he was available.
Okay. So, good. Anything else on Aquifer? Okay, so telecommunication tower, bylaw.
Well, the personal wireless service.
Yeah. So last time we spoke on this, we agreed there were five topics or five questions that we need to generally answer. And we answered two of them in the last meeting. We said we'd tackle the next three today. How are people feeling? I mean, we've got a meeting on Monday where we just have the public hearing, right?
For the purpose and aquifer protection.
Okay, so we this one is not on the agenda for Monday.
Not as a public hearing. We didn't want to put too potentially controversial.
Yeah.
We have this set for the 13th at one of our regular meetings.
Okay.
And has anyone gone through the other three questions? And does anybody have any proposals? Where do we want to maybe take this on Monday, when ideally we would have a little bit more time and won't be so late?
So your questions are which ones? The setbacks, the process?
Yeah, I'm sorry. It's
height setback.
Yeah. Exemption.
And application procedure or decision criteria?
Yeah.
Special permit requirements, height and setbacks, and then application procedure. Right?
Correct.
Yeah. I mean, I went through the special permit requirements, and from my perspective, it looked pretty comprehensive, the ones that have been proposed. Question that Jesse asked, because I believe you put this together, right?
Mm-hmm.
Was, are there any other requirements we want to consider that'll have some sort of potentially visual impact, like no light spillage, dark skies compliant?
Pretty close, so that we could reasonably handle it Monday. And we probably need to want to go through it again individually and see if anything pops out.
That's fine.
Yeah. We all commit to reviewing this over the next week, coming prepared on Monday to knock out these last few questions. And it may be helpful to have
Yeah.
I hate to drag this out, but get so late sometimes. And this is not exactly the same time.
The question I have on the heights and setbacks, where did the numbers that are in here, where did they come from?
It's part of the template from what I, you know, I did some, let's see, the it's right now in the draft residential height setbacks.
Yeah, I mean, I have nothing to gauge,
right.
Mm. You know, sort of what's required, what's reasonable versus,
well,
you know,
the
sure, make them 35 feet, you know. But I have a feeling that's not reasonable.
Well, you get into some of the things like the FAA. And
well, yeah.
For
yeah,
the,
yeah,
you
yeah.
know, the 150 feet is not a short structure.
Right.
Well, I took a look at the heights and a few other bylaws, and it appears that 120 is the max for residential locations.
Like, can we maybe get just a grid of, let's select 3-4 towns and understand what they do as far as setbacks go, as far as height requirements go.
Yep.
I don't know what towns we want to choose from. Who's our favorites?
Or as we have, are there towns that council knows has recently updated theirs?
Probably ones he works for.
Yeah.
So we can use those.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think he did say that this was sort of a refinement of what he's worked with over the past in many, many years. So, yeah.
Yeah, we just like a little bit more reassurance.
Yeah, context. Yes,
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
All right. So then for that meeting, for Monday's meeting, we've got two public hearings and
So, related to that, we wanted to send out a letter to town meeting members, boards, committees, and commissions, reminding them of the public hearing.
Yep.
And I just prepared something in draft. It was separately on your desk as a separate handout. These usually go out through the town clerk.
Oh. Yep. Looks good.
In 5.63 it says this section will be entirely replaced with a new section 5.63 entitled telecommunications bylaw.
Mm-hmm.
Is that really what we're going to call it?
I think that's what Ray has called it.
That's what he says across the top.
Well, this is Jesse's document.
This
the other one is wireless telecommunications zoning.
That's what I was talking about.
Probably should call it wireless.
And what's, I mean, is it calling it a bylaw in its own right? Is that correct? Or is it? Section 563 of the zoning bylaw. I mean, is it a standalone bylaw?
Wireless telecommunications.
Now, isn't smart growth, aren't those the downtown smart growth bylaw, which just happens to be part of our zoning bylaw?
Well, downtown smart growth is a district, right?
section of a bylaw called a bylaw.
You could call it special permit requirements for wireless telecommunication facilities.
Structures.
Because it's a use by special permit.
Gateway Smart Growth District listed in the bylaw.
So we call it wireless telecommunication.
Just wireless telecommunications section of the, see, it already says it's section 5.63 of the zoning bylaw, so this section will be entirely replaced with a new section 5.6.3 entitled wireless telecommunications.
It seems like we should call it personal wireless service facilities. That
yeah.
seems to be the common.
Yeah, because that's title. The. And that fits in section 5.6, which is uses by special permit, right?
Yeah.
Is that what it's going to be, 5.6? Because this says 5.3.
Well, it's 5.6.3.
Well,
uses by special permit.
Ray actually has in the draft, he says to delete in its entirety section 5.3, commercial communication structures are replaced with a new section 5.3, personal wireless communications facilities. So that's probably what it should be called, personal wireless telecommunication facilities.
I also said it's 5.3.
No, 5.3 is a table of uses.
Yeah, that'll be.
Okay.
Yeah, that needs to be updated. It's 5.6.3.
5.6.3.
So, personal.
Clerk to distribute.
Thank you.
All right. Next up, the zoning amendment workshop. Keep going.
Well, keep it down.
Well, so it just seems it's great that George is.
This is the same stuff
this.
that we had included last time, but I thought we were going to have more time on the agenda tonight. So,
but the workshop implies something outside of this forum, right? Are we going to have something outside of it?
No, I think it's just a space just to work.
Oh, I
yeah,
see.
Just
okay.
on the agenda, just
all right.
rather than call it, you know,
workshop
just,
for us.
So it's
yeah.
kind of clear that it's not something that we're tackling at town meeting right away. It's just something that we're working on.
Yeah, we'll keep carrying this on the
yeah.
agenda, and we will get to it when we get through these other ones. All right, and we got minutes.
Separate, we printed out. Sorry, the this document is protected.
I didn't realize that. Sorry.
So we'll make sure to get you the unprotected so you can make your edits.